University Church in Yale. Today is a very special day in the life of UCY. In addition to taking part in Eucharist, we are going to be celebrating All Saints and All Souls Day, as you can see by this display over here. This is a day in a liturgical calendar where we remember our ancestors in faith, those who come from the beginning and those who we've loved and have gone on and died. During our prayers today, there will be an opportunity for you to add the names of your beloved to our display by adding names to the link of chains of names. We're also blessed today because we are going to be led by three student speakers, Hannah, and Andrea. I know that they've worked diligently on preparing for what they're going to say today, and we give thanks to God for the way that they are going to bless us. And now we rise in body and spirit and join me in the call to worship as printed in your bulletin. In all our weakness and strength, with our joy and our sorrow,
we come to be your people, O God.
Grounded in faith and eager with questions, singing our praise and bringing our prayers,
we come to be your people, O God.
Filled with saintly determination, yet mindful of our human limitations,
we come to be your people, O God.
Made strong in your endless love for us, we know ourselves to be yours, and
we come to be your people, O God.
Connected to all who came before us, encouraged by all who still surround us,
we come to be your people, O God.
May we truly live as your people, seeking, hoping, and resting in you.
As we continue to come. Amen. Amen.
Almighty God, you have knit your people together
in one great cloud of witnesses, the mystical body of your child, Jesus Christ. Grant us grace to follow our ancestors in faith, in lives of faith and commitment, and to know the inexpressible joys you bestow upon those who love you. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
The peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
Please greet those around you. It can be with a wave or a peace sign or a handshake, however you prefer. Please join me in the prayer of illumination. Lord,
to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Help us now to hear what you say to us today. Amen.
A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin that clings so closely, and let us run with perseverance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, who for the sake of the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, disregarding its shame, and has taken his seat at the right hand at the throne of God. Consider him who endured such hostility against himself from sinners, so that you may not grow weary or lose heart. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
I will bless God all the time,
and praise shall I be in my mouth.
I will glory in the Most High.
Let the humble hear and rejoice.
Proclaim with me the greatness of God.
Let us exalt God's name together.
I saw and God answered me,
and delivered me out of all my fear.
Look upon the Most High and be radiant,
and let not your faces be ashamed.
I called in my affliction, and God heard me,
and saved me from all my troubles.
Taste and see that the Lord is good.
Happy are those who trust the Most High.
Fear the Most High, you that are God's saints.
For those who fear God lack nothing.
Blessed are all you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. This is the good news of the gospel.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Reflections with us this morning. All three of them have been reflecting especially on our Hebrews text for the day, thinking about what it means that we are told that there is so great a cloud of witnesses that is with us across our Christian journeys as we think about All Saints and All Souls today. Now both, or all three, Andrea, Hannah, and Hannah are fantastic. If you don't know them, you're having a chance to get to know them today, and I encourage you to say hello after the service. Andrea is a junior in Saybrook. She comes to us from California and is a joint degree or major in, let's see if I can get all of this, in Earth and Planetary Science and Ethnicity, Race, and Migration, so EPS and ERNM. Thank you, Andrea, for all you have to share with us today. Hannah Mark will be speaking next. Hannah is also a junior in Benjamin Franklin College. Hannah comes to us from Montana and is a history of science, medicine, and public health major. And last, but certainly not least, is Hannah Vase, who also comes to us from California. Hannah is a joint degree student with the Divinity School and the School of the Environment. I can't wait to hear from all three of them, and I know you are excited as well, so thank you for all that you have prepared. In between each of their reflections, we will be singing the hymn that is on the next page for Everyone Born. So I'm going to invite the cantor, Mac, to come forward. Mac will lead us in the beginning of verse 1. We'll join where it says all. We'll sing verse 2 all together. Then Andrea will come up and we'll sing verses 3 and 4 between the other reflections. So thank you, Mac.
Thank you. All Saints' Day and All Souls' Day are, to me, some of the most mystical holidays in the Christian tradition. Each year, my family celebrates these holidays through a cultural interpretation. Prayer becomes embodied. I do my best to carry this practice with me to college. On my living room coffee table lie bundles of flowers, colorful paper, and trinkets. They evoke so much joy and memories, so much so that if it weren't for the photos of elderly relatives smiling from behind the glass of a picture frame, you would hardly be able to guess that it was a meditation on death. My apartment kitchen is filled with the smell of pastries baking in the oven and the living room, with the smoke of burning sage and candles. These billowing clouds that fill my home as I prepare my ofrenda, or an altar, become a literal manifestation of the clouds of witnesses that watch over us as we travel along our spiritual journeys through this life on earth. The readings today, like celebrations of All Souls Day, pose an interesting problem. We're supposed to rejoice and be faithful because we know that we have a cloud of witnesses cheering us on. But as the ones we love pass from this life into the next, and we begin to match faces, names, and memories to this cloud, how can you position yourself in the elation of running a race and being cheered on? When you're sitting in the pew at a funeral mass mourning the loss of a friend, or a classmate, or a grandparent, or a neighbor, how are you supposed to celebrate that devastation with music and with flowers? Even the prospect of honoring death becomes perverse in the face of immense grief. To lose a loved one at any stage in life is terrifying. No words can begin to characterize that kind of loss. We live in a material world of derelationality, where powerful institutions and structures are enabled to carry out mass death, because it's easier to imagine humans as faceless hordes, more creatures than souls. This year, I'm particularly mourning the senseless loss of lives in Gaza and Israel and Acapulco at the hands of institutions of violence and climate disaster. From oceans away, I see their faces and the young faces that I put up on my ofrenda. Children and teenagers, taken from this world too soon, smiling on an altar that should be reserved for great-grandparents. The promise of resurrection is a deliverance from this terror. We mourn now and know that someday, somewhere, somehow, we will be comforted. Death is not forever, and resurrection is a promise. And that is enough to inspire me to keep dreaming of a better world, a possible world, where people get to die of old age, surrounded by friends and family, who get to celebrate their peaceful departures from this world. My brilliant friends in JCBS, or the Christian Jewish Bible Study, have challenged me to think beyond traditional conceptions of resurrection. What if resurrection occurs every day when you wake up? Would you feel differently about life if tomorrow morning wasn't guaranteed? What if resurrection occurs every time you decide to be a kinder, more loving person? What if it was cyclical rather than linear, a process rather than a nebulous promise of an event in the far future? Then maybe you will find yourself in a position like mine, this All Souls Day, on my knees before a chaotic altar that looks more like a botched DIY Pinterest project than a real ofrenda, at 1 a.m, because the pea set had to get submitted first. My housemates smelling the burning offerings and asking, who's smoking in the house again? And all of a sudden you realize that the grief that once consumed you no longer does so. This movement from grief to comfort is liberation. This movement from grief to comfort is, in its own way, resurrection. And that death is worth celebrating.
Table, the user, the youth. Hebrews chapter 12 have always had a special place in my heart, because when I was a child, my mom and made my siblings and I memorize the entire first half of the chapter set to a song, so that song has been playing in my head over and over this week as I prepare for this reflection. In the past, I've always been drawn to the second half of the verse, of verse 1, which reads, "And let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of faith." This part was especially meaningful to me because running was an important part of how I connected to my faith. During the pandemic, me, my brother Caleb, my sibling Toby, and my dad would all go on runs through the empty, sagebrush-covered hills near our home in Montana. And for me, these long and sometimes lonely runs were a parallel to my faith journey. Running, like faith, takes effort. Even when you're running with other people, you're the one that has to keep going, step after step. And sometimes it's wonderful. You run through gorgeous mountain passages, you feel like your feet are flying and you're on top of the world. And sometimes it's really hard. You struggle, you slog up steep hills, it's hot and you run out of water and you're exhausted. I can trace a lot of moments in my faith life, some high and some low, but the Hebrews 12 verse 1 verse has always brought me comfort that even though there were these joys and challenges of faith, there was always that underlying current and assurance that comes from looking to Jesus, from that command to fix your eyes on Jesus, and that deep comfort in knowing that my path has been marked out before me. And then I came to college. Physically, I stopped running, and spiritually, my faith entered a time of tumult. I was wrestling with the struggle of college itself, but also hammering out aspects of my identity. Who am I and where do I belong? And most importantly, how do I reckon my faith with being queer? In the running metaphor of faith, it seemed like I had begun up a steep and rocky mountain and I couldn't see the top. The fixing your eyes on Jesus command felt unreachable, because how was I supposed to follow him when I couldn't even see him? When I wasn't even sure if these different parts of me, if being queer and being a Christian, could coexist. I used to have a recurring dream as a child, where in the dream I was moving through life and then suddenly I was struck with this sinister and all-encompassing darkness, this blindness. Suddenly I couldn't see anything around me. I couldn't see myself and I didn't know if I existed. In the dream I would beg the people around me to touch me and ask them, "Can you really see me? Am I here?" And then I would turn to God and pray, "I can't see myself. Am I real?" This time of identity struggle was a lot like that dream. I had lost sight of myself. I didn't know where I ended and the darkness began. I felt like I'd run out of faith. And in these moments, I remembered the beginning of the Hebrews verse, which reads, "Therefore, since we have so great a cloud of witnesses surrounding us, let us also lay aside every encumbrance and the sin that so easily entangles us." And then comes the second part, "And let us run with endurance the race that is set before us." I'd forgotten about the clouds of witnesses. I'd forgotten that this running of faith was not something that I was supposed to do alone. We are running because of the witnesses. And the word witness here means simultaneously a person of faith and the proof and evidence for our faith. It was like that moment in the dream where, when I lost sight of myself and everything familiar, I turned first to the people around me, asking them to touch me, see me, orient me, when I couldn't see beyond the darkness. And I remembered, which I'm probably not quoting accurately, Pastor Jenny at one of the deacon's meetings telling us that sometimes when you run out of faith, you have to be carried on the faith of others. Clouds of witnesses in our own life are people who embody the journey of faith, people who surround us and remind us that we're not running the race of faith alone. For me, this cloud of witnesses has been in great part the community at UCY, Pastor Jenny and Pastor Ian, the student deacons, the students at catechesis, the elders. It's also been my parents, grandparents, siblings, and friends, and the saints who have gone before. And sometimes we might be a witness in someone else's life of faith. There are still moments when I feel like I've lost sight of God. Perhaps some of you can relate. I want to encourage you, if those moments ever do arise, to look for your cloud of witnesses in the church community or in the communion with friends, families, and neighbors. The people around us are a tangible reminder of God's presence, and they are a reminder that we are not meant to travel this faith journey alone. Thank you.
Even when it brings water we need, I still sometimes go, not another cloudy day. But for the author of Hebrews, in a water-scarce area, would a cloud be hoped for and anticipated? It'd probably bring some level of comfort and reassurance. Nourishment is here. When it comes to a cloud of witnesses, I wonder how I would characterize those witnesses. Are they cheering? Are they silently supporting? I hope that I think of people patiently and gently observing, knowing that they were once here too. Returning back to that cluster of evaporated water, I think about my water management and dynamic earth classes. The cycle that water is in is hard to avoid mentioning. Timing-wise, clouds make up a pretty small part of that cycle. There's something called the residence time of water, which admittedly is a little niche, but it's about how long a droplet of water is part of a particular stage of the water cycle. So how long it's a water raindrop versus how long it's part of a stream or river, and how long it's part of an ocean wave before it turns on to the next thing. The bigger the body of water, the more time a droplet spends there. So for an area like the ocean, a drop of water spends at least a few hundred years before evaporating. Compared to that, that same droplet spends usually only days to weeks as a cloud before falling to the ground and running to a river that flows into the sea. So while the author of Hebrews probably wasn't thinking about the hydrologic cycle, how does that cycle help me appreciate this cloud that they mentioned, this dense clustering of witnesses that are before and around me? Because I don't think the Hebrews author was thinking about how temporary clouds are in order to make a point about the witnesses surrounding us. But I could think about how different witnesses played temporary roles in my life and how they were really important for one season or another. I also think that humility comes to mind. A molecule of water isn't impressive or weighty or nourishing by itself. It needs to be linked with millions of others to form a cloud. And in the water cycle, it only spends a fraction of its life as that cloud. But I do think it is helpful if I understand how many number of particles there are to form that cloud. That just emphasizes how great the witnesses need to be in order to form a cloud that surrounds us. So in thinking about the cloud of witnesses that surround me, I hope I appreciate them for the impressive, weighty,
refreshing persons they are and how they come together. I think about the role models I had growing up, about the grandpa I never met, the cousin who left too soon, and about all the living saints around me. So many came before me, and they all learned to navigate their journeys in the world. I hope that I will learn to be a simple drop of water too, joining with thousands to witness to what God is already doing in the world. Amen.
Aren't they amazing? Let's get another round of applause. Thank you, Hannah. Thank you, Hannah. Thank you, Andrea. And I want to invite all of you in a similar way. I think that you each could come up here and say something that was meaningful and important. And so as you go about your week, maybe think about what a cloud of witness means to you as well and what you might say. But special thanks to the three of you and to the student deacons. So we're now moving into our time of prayer. And this morning, as Emily mentioned, we're holding together 2 days in the Christian calendar, All Saints and All Souls. In All Saints Day, we remember and honor the saints that have used their lives to give praise to God and to shape the life of church and society. You may think of saints that you have known since you were a child, your patron saint, a saint that you admire, a saint you pray to for intercession or guidance, a saint that may not be venerated in an official way, but someone historically or in your life who inspires you through their witness. During our time of prayer, you have time to remember and think of saints that are meaningful to you. And if you wish, you can come forward and write their name on individual pieces of paper or names and add it to the prayer chain. This week also commemorates All Souls, the day in the Christian calendar when we honor and remember our loved ones who have died. Even as they are no longer here with us in a physical way, their witness, their memories, and the ways that they shaped us remain. During our time of prayer, you're invited similarly to honor their memory by adding their names to different pieces of paper. Emily and Lily co-imagined and co-created the liturgy for today and this beautiful altar that you see, and they will be there to help you to add your chains to the link so that we'll have one long chain of names. After worship, we invite you to take a moment to go up to the altar table and take in the prayer chain, the photos of loved ones that people in our congregation have brought with them, and the altar cloth, which I'll say a bit more about later, that Lily made for this week. As Frances Weller wrote, grief and love are sisters, woven together from the beginning. Their kinship reminds us that there is no love that does not contain loss, and no loss that is not a reminder of the love we carry for what we once held close. Let us enter together into a time of remembering and honoring. And as Monfay plays piano, you're invited as you wish to come forward and write names on the pieces of paper. Thank you. Thank you. Chance to come forward after worship, you're welcome to add more names to the chain. I now invite you all to join me in prayer. Loving God, how sweet it is to remember your beloved who have come before us. It is all too easy to feel alone in this life, to feel misunderstood or unseen, to feel particular in our grief or suffering that can feel too hard to put words to. And yet you know us. You claim us and love us and call us yours. You connect us to so great a cloud of witnesses, those named here and those whose names we do not know to perceive, strangers and loved ones and saints whose stories intertwine within our own. Thank you for creating us to be such a connectional people. We long for true communion with you and with one another. We bring to you these names, those written here and those written on our hearts that are a part of our story. Thank you for the lives of our friends, our family, our mentors, our children, our loved ones. We miss them still. May their memory be a comfort. May we live with the love they spring up in us as something to be shared. Our world is weighed down by such suffering, O Lord. Move swiftly to bring true peace. The grief is too much for us to bear, the violence too great. Too many souls are departing their earthly journeys, O God. We know you weep with us and with them. So peace our great peacemaker. Soften hardened hearts. Where there is dehumanization, revive humanity. Help us to find our place in protecting one another, in protecting your creation. Like little children, we come to you as we are. And I now want to invite everyone to put your hand on your heart and take a moment to bring your individual prayers to God. Prayers of joy, prayers of concern, prayers of hope or lament, prayers about schoolwork or family or friends. For a moment in silence, share with God what is on your heart. Abiding Spirit, receive our prayers. Receive our love for all who have departed. Receive our appreciation of the great cloud of witnesses that surround us still. Center us, open us, calm us, renew us, and send us out a people awakened to your grace, your love, and your compassion.
Beloved, as we worship today, we offer our whole selves to God, all that we have and all that we are. Like the saints who've gone before us, we pray that God will help us be bold in our mission and in our witness. May we who have been given so much give freely, ministering in God's compassion to the multitudes. The offering will now be received.
There's a great camp meeting.
There's a great camp meeting.
Ooh, great camp meeting in the promised land.
Oh, walk together, children, don't you get weary. Walk on, my children, don't you get weary. Just to walk together, children, don't you get weary. There's a great camp meeting in the promised land.
Oh, walk together, children, don't you get weary.
Here at the center station, if you want gluten-free, please come here. If you don't wish to receive but wish but would like to have a blessing, simply don't hold out your hands and let the server know. And now, we start this ancient prayer of the church. So in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith and we sing. Especially those we name in our hearts before you today, Since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, strengthen us to run with perseverance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory. We feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Thank you.
given yourself to us, Jesus.
Now we give ourselves to others.
Your love has made us a new people.
As a people of love, we serve your glory.
Your glory fills our hearts.
Help us glorify you in all our lives. Amen.
And now a very silly song to end our All Saints celebration.
Creation and to animals and those that have gone extinct. And I encourage you to come take a look at it. It's quite beautiful. Next week, we are in for another epic Sunday. Sarah Shapiro will be leading our special music service, in this case, leading a piece called Requiem for a Troubled World. It is gorgeous. It is prayerful. It is beautiful. And we're very excited for your leadership and to hear from it. So in place of the sermon, we will hear this music piece. And we encourage you to come and to join us. You'll also notice that Advent is coming up soon. Advent is the season of expectation and hope right before Christmas. And every year, we make an Advent devotional comprised of what you write. So it could be a prayer, you could submit a hymn that's meaningful to you that you're responding to, or some kind of reflection. But we love it when new folks participate, and so all are welcome. Feel free to talk to me or to Emily or Pastor Ian, and we would love to help and include you in the submission. Submissions are due next Monday, which is why I'm mentioning it now. So it's coming up. We would love to hear from you.
Monday a week.
As in, not tomorrow, but on November 13th. And there's always a little wiggle room, so just let us know you're going to submit something by the 13th, and we would love to include you. Today at 2 p.m., Chapel on the Green is celebrating its 15th anniversary. Felicita Isabel, our former associate pastor, was involved in founding Chapel on the Green, so if you'd like to go, I believe Ian will be there and would love to have you join. This evening is Holy Queer, which is an interfaith LGBTQ space that I help lead, that all students are welcome to. If you want to come, let me know. And then last but not least, a lot of announcements today, so sorry. Some students that are involved in our church are organizing an event called Barbie, Gender, and Christian Faith on Thursday night. Dinner will be provided. I think it's going to be a good time. So if you like the Barbie movie and want to think about its relationship to gender and Christianity, you'll be among friends. Just let me know if you want to have more details. And with that, let us turn to these good and ancient words from Micah. With what shall I come before the Lord?
And bow myself before God on high.
God has told you, O mortal, what is good.
And what does the Lord require of you?
But to do justice.
To do justice.
And to love kindness.
To love kindness.
And to move humbly with your God.
And move humbly with your God.
Amen. Go now with the love of God, with the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, which surpasses all understanding, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, now and forevermore. Amen. Go in peace.